Okay, so I'm going to walk you through a little bit on energy, a history, a story. Then I'm going to try to scare the pants off of you. And then I hope to leave you feeling empowered. I'm going to start, though, with a public confession. Right, my name is Richard Alley, and I'm a climate scientist. Now, that gets a very different response than if I said I'm an earth scientist, or I'm a material scientist, or I'm a rocket scientist, or whatever. And there are reasonably many people in this great land that if you say I'm a climate scientist, you just ended the discussion. You might have started the argument, you might have just turned everything off, but the discussion ends. And I have had the emails from them, the ones that say you're a liar, the ones that say, I hope you suffer. I'm going to find you. I have contacted your administration and I am trying to get you fired right now. And they come through. Now, I'm actually proud to be a climate scientist, and I hope to show you that by using what we do and a whole lot of other people do, that not only do we get a cleaner environment that is more ethical, but we also get a better economy. Okay, now I came to this by a very roundabout way. I am trained as a geologist. Here we are talking about rocks in Hawaii. I mapped rocks in the desert in Utah. I mapped rocks in the cold in Antarctica. And I worked one summer for an oil company. It was fascinating. Nice, interesting people. But eventually I got to Greenland and Antarctica, and I was looking at how snow turns to ice without melting, because it's the same physics that engineers use in powder metallurgy and ceramics, and I wanted to test the understanding of the physics. If you ever get a chance to go to the ice sheets, I recommend it. It is a fascinating undertaking. At the time I took this particular picture, the newspaper that you see on the left was about a month old because we hadn't been resupplied. I can tell you, though, if you look on the right, that it was perfectly fine. That is, it was perfectly fine when you could get to it. So there are certain things that come with going to the ice. But in going to the ice, I started to get under the skin of the ice. And I started to look at the layers, and the summer, and the winter, and the summer, and the winter, and that's how much it snowed, and that's what was blowing through the air, and that's a history of the climate. And I was a climate scientist. And I surely didn't intend this, but it has been an absolutely fascinating ride. Now, when we started going, communications were a little bit shaky, and there were days, there were weeks that you couldn't get anything out to the real world. Now, of course, you'd have your satellite phone, and now, of course, almost all of us, almost all the time, are completely connected. It is a fascinating exercise. Go into a school class somewhere and pull out your cell phone and say, what is it? And they'll give you, so, oh, it's your phone, or it's your cell phone, or it's your smartphone. The people up front will say, well, it's sort of a little old one. You're not very cool, are you? And then say, what's it made of? What's it made of? I did this once in a class, and after the uncomfortable silence, a very bright student said, cell phone parts? What's it made of? There's a little bit of sand in the glass in the silicon for the chip. There's a little bit of oil in the plastic, and there's the right rocks, the ones with the rare earth elements and the copper and what have you. This is sand and oil and rocks and science and engineering and design and marketing. Without relativity, the GPS would get lost. Einstein is in here. And we couldn't design the computer chip without knowledge of quantum mechanics. Bohr and Feynman are in here. And we do use our knowledge of drifting continents to help find those right rocks. Wegener is in here. Right? This is science and engineering writ very, very large. And yet there really are good people in this country who will take this and send me a note that says, you scientists don't know what you're talking about. Right? It's, remember this. This is science in your hand. And it works. Now, this is powered. If I were sitting on an exercise bicycle connected to a generator, I could just about generate enough energy to run the slide projector, and that's about it. What the dancers were a little higher energy while they were dancing, but day and night, summer and winter, a human being is 100 watts. One old bright light bulb makes everything you do go, and everything they do go. But you know, I had a nice lunch. I didn't spend the summer hoeing corn, so I didn't starve to death this winter. It was done by a tractor with diesel. And I'm not heating the room, and I didn't cool it in the summer. If you take all the energy use in the U.S. economy, divide it by the number of people, and turn it into these units, it is 10,000 watts. What you can do for yourself is 100. What is done for you is 10,000. And it's fantastic. We love it. We do not want to go back to hoeing corn all summer. Unless you like it, okay? This should be a choice, not a requirement, okay? Now, we are here at Penn State. Down the hill is State College. State College is a suburb of Penn State, really. Because when Penn State was founded, there was no State College. We were founded up the hill from the iron furnace. And there was a little town down there taking care of the iron furnace. And the iron furnace would have looked like this. And it was turning red dirt and limestone flux and charcoal into the iron that built the East. And charcoal came from trees. Lots and lots and lots of trees. A furnace and the people that took care of it took a square mile of trees a year. There were lots of furnaces and forges. This is Penn's woods, it's Pennsylvania. There's trees all over the place. 100 years ago, the first forester of the Commonwealth, Rothrock, wrote about the Pennsylvania desert. There were essentially no trees in the state. There are a million deer in Pennsylvania, there were essentially none. There are no Nittany Lions, there wasn't a deer to eat and there wasn't a tree to do it behind. We burned trees far faster than they grew back. We hit crises because of that. You don't see well at night by firelight, so what do? You send Yankees out to the world ocean to kill whales and cook them so you have whale oil. A few biofuels of other sorts, but so we had whalers out there scouring the world ocean until they couldn't find any more whales to kill. And eventually we switched to this. And we have whales and trees because we switched. This was published in Vanity Fair in the year 1861. This is the grand ball given by the whales in honor of the discovery of the oil wells in Pennsylvania. Oil's well that ends well, right? This is right before the Civil War. The oil wells of our native land, may they never secede. We have whales and trees because we switched to burning fossil trees and fossil algae, but we're burning them fantastically faster than nature makes more. They accumulated over a few hundred million years. We're burning them over a few hundred years. We are headed towards that next crisis with very high confidence. What we make is huge. What we put out to the curb for the trash collector is a half a ton per person per year. The fossil fuels make CO2 20 tons per person per year. And that will change the climate. We knew that scientifically before Einstein, before Wegener, before Feynman and Bohr. It was really worked out by the Air Force right after World War II, because CO2 soaks up the heat radiation from the hot engine of the enemy bomber, and CO2 soaks up the heat radiation from the sun-warmed Earth. Now, initially, what does it do? We warm the climate a little bit. You see the ice melting back in Greenland, and it makes fairly interesting things. But you look a little more, and you say even a little ice melting back in Greenland might have mattered when Hurricane Gustav came to New Orleans. You can see a little water would make a difference. But if we keep burning, if we take off all the mountaintops, if we frack everything, then we hit the crisis. But we hit the crisis in a world where we might have committed ourselves to enough sea level rise to disappear out of the top of that picture. We can turn the world so hot that it gets hard to grow our food. We can possibly make it so hot that you can't go outside of your air conditioning without dying, and sometimes in places. You do not leave your puppy in the car locked in on a hot summer day because it's too hot, you die. It is possible by the time some of the younger ones here are old that we will start to get to that in the world if we don't change our ways. Now, suppose that we decide to learn while we burn and build a sustainable energy system. Could we do this? Two numbers. The one on the top is what humanity now uses for all of that external energy for the whole world, averaged across the world, 0.035. What is available from the sun? 240. What we're using? 0.03. What we need? What is available? 240. Could we do this? Right? Abe Lincoln, before he's president, is on the stump. He would have loved TEDx. I'm sorry. He would have loved this. All right? He's speaking about why we need learning, why we need engineers and inventions and patents. And he says at some point the wind is an untamed and unharnessed force, and one of the greatest discoveries to be made will be the taming and harnessing of it. Right? Now, we filmed this in our TV shows. Jeff Haynes Styles, and the ranchers love it. They put 5% of the ranch into wind. They get mailbox money. You go out to the mailbox and you get money. $5,000 or so per turbine per year. Pays a lot better than the steers down at the bottom, but you can still run the steers. You just put a little bit of this in. If we build a wind farm on the windy parts of the plains and deserts of the world, it is far more energy than all of humanity now uses. It doesn't have to be in your backyard. It doesn't have to be in the forest. It doesn't have to be in the water. Just the winds, the windy parts of the plains and deserts, far more than we use. The sun offers way more than the wind, 100 times. Okay. So here are the dreaded bullet points. The opportunities out here are amazing. We can build, we can get off of the treadmill, burn something far faster than it comes back, run out and face a crisis. We know how to build a sustainable system now. We can get energy that will supply everyone, including the people that don't have oil and coal and natural gas, because the sun shines and the wind blows. The scholarship is very clear. This helps the economy, as well as the environment, as well as ethics. It helps the economy as well. Now suppose for a moment that you decide you want to do something about this. And you say, Dr. Alley, what do I do about this? And I say, don't take your marching orders from me. I'm a poor old geologist who happened to become a climate scientist because I dug holes in Greenland. Take it from you. Figure out what you want, what works for you. But you might think along these lines. Okay, first of all, there is a big picture thing. The people that send me the nasty notes, by and large, are actually good people. And they care very deeply, and they've got a little bit of the wrong information. And there's a talking thing. You have neighbors, there's a voting thing. I have talked to quite a number of very high elected officials who know the reality of this, and they're hoping that you help them. You can't solve it all. Nobody can solve it all, but we can. And if you picked something that worked for you and said, here is something that's on the bleeding edge, and this could be the leading edge. If we all did that, I can virtually guarantee you that we will have a world with icebergs and rainbows. Thank you.